Hi everybody, this is Dr. A. For our second video on analytic techniques, we're going to look at photometry. So photometry measures light intensity without consideration of wavelength. We covered spectral photometry in a previous video, where spectral photometry measures light intensity of a specific narrow range of wavelength. Wavelength of light is represented here. So some of the applications of photometry are going to be in fluorometry, chemiluminescence, turbidimetry, and nephelometry, and we're going to look at each of those. So let's start with fluorometry. So the basic instrumentation, it measures concentrations of solutions that contain a fluorescent molecule. It will emit a short wavelength after it's been excited with a high energy excitation light. A mechanical attenuator controls light intensity, and the concentration of whatever you're measuring is directly proportional to the amount of emitted light or emitted EMR. So again, this is your application are wide, but in your day-to-day life, if you've ever played with glow-in-the-dark paint, that's fluorometry. So for the glow-in-the-dark paints and other things to work, you have to shine bright light on it first. So it has to be loaded up with light. And then if you turn all the lights off or put it somewhere where it's dark, then it glows and it emits a lower light, a shorter wavelength light. So the advantages and disadvantages of fluorometry is, the advantage is it has great specificity and sensitivity. So it increases sensitivity and specificity of like immunoassays and nucleic acid probes. The disadvantage is it is very sensitive to environmental changes. So again, the fluorometry principle involves exciting compounds with light EMR. So it's high energy, short wavelength light, and then detecting the emitted light or emitted EMR, which is going to be at a lower energy, longer wavelength light, and it is always detected at a 90 degree angle. So when we were in spectrophotometry, everything, all the whole detection was linear in a straight line. This one is at an angle. So you're going to shine the light in one direction, and then that light's going to go off, and then the sample is going to glow, and you're going to detect the light emitted at a 90 degree angle. The applications of fluorometry are going to be fluorescence polarization immunoassay, time-resolved fluorescent immunoassays, and then microarrays in DNA sequencing. Next, we have chemiluminescence. The principle is that in chemiluminescence, light is produced from a chemical or electrochemical reaction, which then produces light without heat. The chemical energy that is generated by the reaction produces excited intermediates that decay to a ground state with the emission of photons, which are light particles. So you get a chemical reaction that generates light. No excitation radiation or monochromators are required. So in fluorometry, you had to have the excitation emission, so you had to bombard it with light first in order for it to emit light. In chemiluminescence, that is not the case. It involves the oxidation reactions of luminol, acridium esters, and dioxythanes. And it is detected with a photomultiplier tube, which is the same type of detector that's used in spectral photometry. It just detects light emitted. One of the practical applications in everyday life of chemiluminescence is your glow-in-the-dark bracelets and things, where if you ever buy a pack of those bracelets or necklaces or glow-in-the-dark or glow-in-the-dark stick, you know that you have to break the ampule, the thing that's inside, for the chemical reaction to happen. And as a chemical reaction happens, light's going to be emitted for a certain amount of time. Once that chemical reaction is completely spent, the little glow stick or glow bracelet is no longer glowing or no longer emitting light. So the applications in the clinical lab are going to be for immunoassays, nucleic probe assays, anything that requires really good sensitivity and specificity also. And then lastly, we have turbidimetry and nephelometry. So turbidimetry is the measurement of the reduction in light transmission that's caused by particle formation. Can be used also in immunoassay if the product is just going to be just turbid, or in different protein assays where it just turns something from clear to cloudy. And the cloudier it is, the more particles are present, so the more concentrated it is. So you have, again, this is an illustration of turbidity from not turbid to extremely turbid. A little cloudy here. So cloudy, turbid, use those terms a little interchangeably. So turbidimetry is going to be measured in a straight line also. So you will have a light source, again, just bombarding light, not specific wavelength. Or here they have a monochromator, maybe you do want to select a specific wavelength, but you can just do it with light. And it will go through a shutter, through the sample or the blank, and then through a detector. So straight line, so it's shining through it. The more turbid it is, the more of the light it's going to absorb, and the less of it's going to be transmitted. The less turbid it is, the more light will go through and be transmitted on the other side. And then nephelometry is the measurement of light scattered by a particulate solution. So you have particles that are suspended in a solution, and those particles can scatter light. The best illustration I see of that is going to be disco ball, or things that like sequins and other things that can scatter light, reflect light that's shone on them. So you shine light on a disco ball, and then it scatters light, and you have little light emitted all over the place. It's just light that's bounced off of the disco ball. And so here in nephelometry, the light bounces off the antibody antigen particles. And so again, you have a light source, could have a monochromator, and then it goes through a shutter, goes through the sample, and then it's going to be detected at an angle. Because again, you don't want to detect what's being shone through the sample. You want to detect the scatter of that light by the particles. You're going to detect it also at a 90 degree angle, very similar to fluorometry. So anyway, so that wraps up those analytical techniques that are associated with photometry. And thank you so much for your attention. There'll be more to come pretty soon.